this is what I'll be doing today. It's actually thinking about the Newton's cradle. It's something that we see in our everyday life, so I'm just trying to find out what's the physics behind all this, the Newton's cradle. What I have discovered from all this is that we see that this is how the Newton's cradle works. So what we can derive from this is that it's actually elastic collision. We can look at the property of the balls that are used. We can see here elastic. We can actually shift this from 1 to something like a lesser value, say 0.5. For everything also.
Gary, use 0, can
use 0.
Because in your syllabus you need to know two numbers. Perfectly elastic and perfectly inelastic.
Okay. Okay, when the value is 0, right, it's actually a perfectly inelastic collision. So this is what happens. You see that the whole system moves together because there is no transfer, the total kinetic energy of the colliding bodies after collision is not equal to the total kinetic energy before collision. This is something that we will learn in the later chapter, Then what we can understand when we set the value to something elastic is that we change it to 1, so now it's perfectly elastic. Now I said this happens, what we mean by elastic collision is actually when the total kinetic energy of the colliding bodies before collision, after collision, is equivalent to the total kinetic energy before collision, which is also initial is equal to kinetic energy minus. Another interesting thing that I found out about the Newton's cradle is that it also observes the law of the conservation of momentum and laws of conservation of energy. Okay, the laws of conservation of energy states that energy can neither be created nor destroyed, it can only be converted from one form to another. We can see that as we let this thing run a little bit further, right? The whole system becomes like that. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel that it might be because of the sound energy that is being created, as in that is being converted from the initial energy. Yeah. So therefore, there is a loss in the whole system of energy. Thus, the whole system becomes like that. I am not sure of it. So, Mr. Lee, you think could it be a possible way of explaining?
What Gary is saying is after a while, the six balls start to move in a random motion. I think if you run interactive physics properly, it can actually run for quite a long time. Gary's one appeared to be running for a short while. I think the reason is because when Gary built this, did you cut and copy and paste?
Yeah, right.
You did?
Cut
and copy and paste? What you do, can you just the simulation, because I need to check that the length are exactly identical. But you, that's why you adjust manually. Did you adjust manually?
Initially I started off with everything the same. Then as time went by, I went to adjust this tool. This tool, I found that it will be out of date. Think now it looks a bit slightly disproportionate.
Okay.
But what happens is that we can actually delete it. maybe she be done a bit up. She actually don't have a visual mind. That's my point.
I think it's not connected. You try it, right?
Yeah, okay, not connected properly.
The middle one, yeah.
Okay. So yeah.
It runs pretty well.
Yeah, but after some time there will still be random mode, right?
Oh, okay.
So,
You know, physics simulation is running on what Gary has pointed out is he's looking at a flaw in the software. The proper thing usually works quite well. Okay. But to help you satisfy your curiosity, because I also played with this before. You make this longer.
Which one?
You'll see that it runs very well. You make this one longer. The one in the middle.
Yeah. Actually, usually it's a
Make this one longer, slightly lower, just by a bit. Slightly lower. Slightly only. Then you can see it behaves very well. Cut the line.
Okay,
drop the ball a bit lower. Slightly okay. Then draw a new line.
Because the Newton's cradle usually comes in odd numbers.
Of real world. Also, you don't have to worry about that if you don't quite understand.
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you for... Okay, thanks. Let's thank Gary for his presentation.
You're welcome.
Okay. Now, can I just... Because since Mr. Lau is here, actually, I intended to use this platform to purchase interactive physics for the school as a way of propelling the way we teach physics in this college. But Mr. Lau has already clearly agreed to buy interactive physics. So maybe we can use this idea, this platform, to maybe you can just let us know how this software has helped or has not helped you at all.
So does it help me to relate some of the concept used in the physics? Yeah, definitely. Better understand how they all life. So you will find that more interesting than rather than normal just blackboard drawing concept. Yeah, each one and we tend to a lesser lecture. So if you want to look at something in a more realistic point of view, it's quite difficult. But actually with this course it's in the real world. This is what close up to. So it's a visual kind of pattern that
does
interesting. You don't work on during the lesson, you work this on yourself, you need outside during the time, you think about especially your electronical, this brain of all things.
This will be a result that I've managed to get from you. Because you are a small group and you are H1, so you can understand my excitement that it has actually been able to help you to some degree to understand physics from a more physics point of view rather than just from a bunch of words and diagrams. Of that physics, the lessons come alive. This is actually one of the ways that we can actually bring forward our education. Because 10 years down the road, I do not expect schools in Singapore to be teaching in the usual way that I've been teaching you. Classroom that we just discussed question. This is something like a preview to lessons of the future. I hope that I have made your H1 lesson interesting. And remember the pass out of the I want to gather your feedback. Okay, thank you very much.
Alright.